Hello, everyone, and welcome to It's Always Sunny in Phoenix, a weekly podcast where we keep you up to date on everything Phoenix Suns basketball. Today, we're going to break down last week's games, including the overtime thrillers against the Blazers and Pelicans. After that, it's all aboard the Bledsoe, Booker, and Warren hype train. The trio has been putting up some great numbers this season. So we'll talk about the excellent play that we've seen out of those guys before we preview next week's games. I'm Charlie, and the whole crew is here today. Mitch, David, what's up, guys?
Not a whole lot. Just excited for some more games like the Portland and Pelicans, I guess.
Yeah, after those, I'm feeling pretty good. They were a lot of fun.
Definitely a fun start to the season after those early losses. But hey, make sure to get a hold of us on social media. Hit us up on Twitter, at Sunny in PHX Pod. Check us out on Facebook under the name Phoenix Suns Multiple Sources. Our email is sunnyinphxpod@gmail.com. And of course, check out the website at sunnyinphxpod.com. And hey, we've been talking about these beautiful back-to-back wins, and I think we can now truthfully say that the cheese is warming up. Oh, what's that? You want that on a t-shirt? Well, you're in luck. Check out the shop page at tpublic.com/user/sunnyinphx.
I like it.
You guys like
that? I love that. Yeah. I just ordered my t-shirts, actually, the other day, so they should be here anytime. Can't wait to start wearing those during games.
You can never have too much cheese for a cheese shirt, so I dig it. I dig that.
That's right. So let's hop right into things and get started with these game reviews. The Suns went 2-1 last week to bring the current record up to 2-4 on the season. And we're excited about these back-to-back overtime wins, but we have to start off with the game against the Clippers in L.A. on Halloween night. And this one ended up final score 116-98 in favor of the Clippers. But there were definitely some nice things that we can talk about when it comes to the Suns. And the whole game was pretty competitive, aside from that pesky second quarter, where the Suns only managed to score 12 points while giving up 9 turnovers. So aside from that quarter, we looked pretty good, especially without having Devin Booker on the floor due to that sprained toe. But it's good to see him back healthy now. So, what are some things that stuck out about the game to you guys?
Yeah, you know, one of the big things that I want to talk about is our presence at the center position. We had, of course, Booker out. We can talk a lot about that. But I really want to talk about Tyson Chandler and how when we were playing with Tyson Chandler on the court, the game was a lot closer. I think that is something that with the lineups, and you can see who he was playing with. If you look at its plus or minus, that was about -7, which isn't the best on the team, but it's not the worst either. He was playing really well against DeAndre Jordan, as much as you can with the athleticism difference. And there were a lot of, in my opinion, ticky-tacky fouls that DeAndre was probably getting away with on the other side, and Tyson just was getting called each time. So he only played about 18 minutes, which forced Alex Len to play 25 minutes. And just the defensive presence wasn't there. And I know that we've kind of been talking a lot how Tyson is playing like the much better center and how Alex Len is kind of disappointed. But I think that was really apparent this game. This team with both those guys in there are just completely different. We have a stronger rebounding presence. We have a stronger defensive presence with Tyson out there, and I think it was most apparent during this Clippers game.
Yeah, I mean, that's all really good stuff. You covered it really well. Last week I talked about how my Halloween plans were to watch a scary movie. So I watched the new version of the Amityville Horror. It was pretty good, but the scariest part of my night by far was this the final score of this game, 116-98. Especially that second quarter. Jeez, I mean, if you want a good scare, go back and watch that second quarter. Whew, 12 points, 9 turnovers, but yeah, I mean, it's the only negative we have to talk about this week, which is great.
Right, and quickly going back to Chandler, just him at his age with his athletic ability holding his own against DeAndre the way he did while he was in there, you just have to give it up for the guy. That stands to his defensive IQ. He knows where to be, and even though DeAndre Jordan may jump over his back and or fly over him, that's going to happen every once in a while, but Chandler does a good job of at least getting in the way against some of those really athletic guys. And let's move it on to another guy. Let's talk about our leading scorer this game a little bit, Brandon Knight. We're always back and forth on Brandon Knight, but this might have been his best shooting game that we've seen from him so far. He went 6 for 13 from the floor, 18 points. The thing I don't like to see on that stat line, 0 boards, 0 assists, 0 steals. So what are we thinking about Knight coming through this game?
Well, what I think is this was his opportunity to start because Booker was hurt. And he probably just wanted to show why he should still be starting and maybe tried a little too hard, forced things a little bit. He only had 2 turnovers, which isn't horrible, but, you know, 2 turnovers and 0 assists doesn't bode well for the old assist to turnover ratio. And yeah, I mean, he, if I'm him, that's what I'm trying to do. I'm trying to prove here's why I should still be starting. So I think that's kind of what the case was a little bit.
While I think that is a good point, I don't think that he was even going to have the possibility of, if he played like stellar and helped us beat the Clippers, that he would start over Booker. And I think he has to know that. I think that EJ and Steve Albert kind of talked about it best. They talked about Jamal Crawford and how Knight should really start looking at how Jamal Crawford plays. He's won 3 six man of the years. I think that Knight can be a Jamal Crawford type of player. And I think that even though he was in the starting lineup, I think he was trying to be that, which is why he was the leading scorer. He didn't really look to rebound or assist. He was just trying to score and score for the team. And I think that is kind of the big takeaway. And I can't fault him too much. We were missing score in this game.
Yeah. And that is a good point. And the other thing is Brandon Knight has to know that being compared to Jamal Crawford is that's a compliment. I mean, people saying he can be like that, that's a huge compliment.
Yeah, and the thing I see between Crawford and Knight, the big difference is Jamal Crawford has control in just many aspects of the game compared to Brandon Knight. They're both good ball handlers. I mean, you can't say Knight's quite like Crawford, but Knight has some solid handles, but you don't see Jamal Crawford dribble between the legs off of his shin and watch it go out of bounds. You just rarely see that. And then another one, control with his shot selection. Crawford seems to take much better shots than some of the things we see Knight throw up. Throw up is a good 2 words for that there. But yeah, I think you guys know where I'm going with that, though.
Yeah, I really like that. And just one thing to know, I mean, Crawford is a really smart player. I think that Knight needs to look how Crawford will initiate contact as much as humanly possible before he takes a shot, whereas Knight looks to not necessarily and will go for more for a step back instead of just stopping and going for the up for the shot. If he did that a little bit more than trying to step back and do a long 2, I think he would get fouled a lot more and his free throw percentage would go up a ton.
Yeah, I think that's all really good. And you know, the step back is something that we have kind of had issues with in the past. When he is hitting it consistently, which he can do here and there, it's great, but most of the time he's just taking these long 2s and bricking them, and it gets very frustrating. So initiating a little bit more contact would definitely be good.
Step back long two, Brandon Knight. All right. But I don't know. Not much more to say. Does the Bledsoe facing the Clippers thing, do you think that means much to him anymore? Or maybe the matchup against Chris Paul might be more of a push. Any comments on that?
I think the matchup that... I guess I'll say that the matchup against Chris Paul is probably more of a push to him. I think he likes to step it up against some of these better point guards or the top point guards in the league. I think more of the rivalry with the whole Clippers thing kind of goes more with PJ Tucker and Blake Griffin than anything else. And it's not that much of a rivalry, but I just don't think those guys like each other.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if they exactly like each other, but at least in this game, it just didn't seem like it was too big of a deal.
Right. It seems like they're kind of past that, even though I think of Chris Paul as the big brother to Bledsoe still. I bet there's a little bit of that, but side note on that PJ Blake thing, when I first moved down here to Arizona, my in-laws were visiting. We were in our tiny little living room, all watching the Suns versus Clippers game, and that's when Blake Griffin and PJ Tucker got into a little tussle, and my wife and I weren't married that long at this point, so like her parents knew me, but they had never watched me watch my team play a game. I got pretty riled up, and I think they met the real me that night, maybe.
And that's the story of how Chuck got divorced.
Okay, but that's just a moment I'll never forget. Let's just move it along. Any more notes from the Clips game?
No, I'm way more excited to talk about these other two.
Right.
Yeah, agreed.
Yeah, let's talk about some fun ones. Suns versus Blazers. Huge win. 118-115. Overtime. Buzzer-beating three-pointer by Eric Bledsoe. Like, how beautiful is that? And this one felt good because it had gone the other way so many times for us Suns fans. Man, how many buzzer beaters have we lost on over the last couple of years just to get this one? It felt really good. So, and Bledsoe, the first thing I want to start off with, we got to talk about Bledsoe. And we've seen him be clutch in the past. I think it was against the Jazz, top of the key, pulled the three over Hayward with the clock running out. I remember watching that, but this one was just so nice. And the note I want to make that we can maybe start off with, Eric Bledsoe played 40 minutes in this game and still had the juice in his legs to put up that fadeaway three to win the game. So I'm excited seeing that Bledsoe is really back in this kind of shape already after missing all that time last year. So I'm hyped. What do you guys think?
As much as we've talked about easing Bledsoe into the with his minutes and everything.
Nah.
He's good to go. He's ready.
Yeah, he looks great out there. He looks like he has not lost shape at all in basketball shape, even in the preseason. He looks like he's just wants to pin his ears back and go, as some older people will say. As Chuck's generation will say. Just kidding.
Yeah.
That was bad. That was really bad. Cut that out.
I'm a millennial just like you, David.
I know. I was going for the fences. But I think that Bledsoe has shown that he's ready to take on some of that clutch action. And I love seeing it. I'm not going to pretend and say, like, oh, I don't want to see him do that. I want to see him do that every single time. Last year, when he had that clutch block against Luis Scola from three to clinch the win against the Raptors last year, I thought it was fantastic. I loved that. I was out of my mind. It was great. I love when Bledsoe shows up because, I don't know, it just makes this team feel like it's got something there, a little bit extra, that we might see like in a year or two in the playoffs. That'll be really nice.
Yeah. Oh, I mean, Bledsoe has looked great. I mean, I was one of those people saying, ease him in, be patient. No, he's ready. This is the best case scenario. He is so ready to go, and it's great. He has just been driving, like, I mean, it looks like he wasn't even hurt. It's great. But the thing I want to talk about in this game, there's a couple things. Conditioning and free throw shooting. So we, our team, aside from PJ Tucker, well, I mean, he's looked a lot better too. But our team is in great shape. They are just running the floor all night, going to overtime and still looking fresh and hitting free throws. You know, that's something that a lot of times when teams get tired, they start to miss free throws, especially when they count. But that wasn't the case in this game or in the game against the Pelicans that we'll talk about next. But I'll just go through really quick. We shot 83.3% from the line, 25 for 30. TJ Warren was 5 for 5. Tyson Chandler, 2 for 2. Eric Bledsoe, 5 for 5. Devin Booker was 2 for 4, which I'll give him a pass on this one, I guess. Alex Len was 6 for 6. Brandon Knight was 3 for 3. Marquise Chris, 1 for 3, and P.J. Tucker, 1 for 2. So, you know, we got to the line a little more, and we capitalized, and that's what kept us in the game and what ultimately helped us win and be in the position for Bledsoe to make the game winner.
Absolutely, and you said the 6 for 6 from Alex Len, and we saw Alex Len play a huge game. This might have been the best we've seen him look. 18 points, 6 boards. Let's talk about Alex Len a little bit.
Yeah, for as much as we talk, not bad, but are concerned about Alex Len and are not sure, and even talking about that Clippers game where he didn't play that well, he brought it against Portland, and it reminds me of what Alex Len can do. When he is not trying to take those bad mid-range jump shots, like, he looks fantastic around the rim, and while he doesn't take contact as well sometimes, he can, and he has some great moves, and I think that really showed against the Blazers. I mean, that 18.6 rebounds, just a mere Tyson 6 points, 18 rebounds, you gotta love it.
Yeah, I mean, we also have to remember that, you know, as of tonight is November 6th, and we play the Lakers tonight. Well, we'll end up talking about that next week, but that's game 7, you know. We've played 7 games by the time that this podcast comes out. So we have to remember that. We can't be too tough on guys through 7 games. Alex Len might have just needed 5 games to warm up, and 5 out of 82 isn't too bad.
Yeah, I don't know about that, but
let's hope Len is properly warmed up. Let's say that.
I mean, yeah, we can say that. we'll say that. It doesn't matter. One thing I want to talk about, just real quick, about this Blazers game. We did have that last second win. I want to talk about how I totally thought we were losing this game. Is it okay for me to just let it all out there? I didn't really talk to you guys about this. This felt like a game that we were gonna lose.
You can be real with us, David.
Buckle up, buckaroos.
I'm being real. This ain't no buckle up, buckaroos. This isn't going off the rails. This is just speaking from the heart, man. We had Damian Lillard get that kind of BS foul call at the end of the game to tie it up, almost send it to double overtime. I mean, I just thought we were losing this game, and I was like, okay, we're going into double overtime. Our guys are gassed. We're tired. We're going to end up losing because Damian Lillard is clutch as all get out and because he got a bad foul call. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, Bledsoe hits a step back three over Lillard. And I was assuming that it was gonna miss. I was yelling at the TV for him to get a better shot than that. And then he made it, and I had to eat all my words.
I haven't been that excited about a Suns basketball game in quite a little bit.
No, I definitely yelled out loud multiple times during that game.
Oh, yeah. I actually asked my wife the next morning if she heard me yell, and she said no, which was very surprising because I was a little worried that I may have awoken the wife right there.
Yeah.
Oh, I was going to say something earlier, and I spaced it, but I remember it now. Alex Len with the footwork looking like Hakeem Elijah Len.
Wow. Wow.
See, I was going to go with Wilt Chamberlain.
Ooh.
That may be better.
What about Jeremy Len?
No.
He doesn't have a good enough haircut for that.
Yeah, no. I'm pretty much just saying that because a lot of announcers get Len and Lin confused.
That's very true.
That's fair.
And it's upsetting. Really annoying.
All right. So, we got to talk about TJ Warren here. I don't think we've been talking about him a whole lot. We're going to talk about him more in a minute. But in this Trailblazers game, TJ was going 11 for 22 from the floor, 5 for 5 from the line. That puts up 27 points. He pulled down 7 boards, 2 steals and a block too. So we're seeing TJ score. We're seeing TJ get steals. We're seeing TJ get rebounds. I mean, everything has improved about this guy this year. I'm really excited about seeing if TJ keeps it all together this year.
Yeah, I mean, TJ's been great. And I know a lot of people have talked about Booker being a most improved player candidate, but I think TJ has burst onto that scene for sure. He's been great.
Yeah, I talked about hoping that he could average about 11 to 15 after that Thunder game where he scored a career high 30. I was talking about how I hope that he can just come back and have like 15 points just to show that consistency is getting there. And what was it? After that Thunder game, he had 26 points. He went down to 15 against the Clippers, but then back up to 27. I mean, dude is putting on the gas still and staying in right around the same amount of points each game, really. I mean, he's kind of his high and low now. His low is 14 points while his high is 30. I'm okay with that compared to some of the games that we had last year where he would have a 27-point game and then, like, a 6-point game.
Right. That's the one thing about TJ, that consistency. I was going to say exactly what you did. It was either 17 points from TJ or 3 or 5 and then another big game. But it's nice that we get to see him putting all this together and just getting buckets. TJ buckets.
Yeah. And sorry to change the subject really quick here, but Archie Goodwin is finalizing a deal with the Pelicans. Just saw that. So that is very interesting timing because he just missed playing his old team.
Glad that timed out that way to tell you the truth.
Oh, yeah. Man. He probably would have went off.
And hey, you know what? I think we might as well move it on and talk about that Pelicans game. And we got to see another overtime victory at the Pelicans' house. Just great. And a few really solid performances from our Suns, but we're going to keep this real. Devin Booker scoring 38 points just a couple of days after his 20th birthday. So let's just talk about how good he looked out there. Go ahead.
He got those shoes that actually fit right. You know, his toes feeling better from after having the two small shoes. It looked it. I mean, if this is what happens when he wears the right size shoes, then watch out.
Yeah, I mean, he was making a smoothie out of the Pelicans in the Smoothie King Arena.
Nice.
No, he looked great. Nice. This was the Booker game that we had all been waiting for, and it was very, very fun.
Right, we got to see a couple really cool shots out of Devin Booker, some big-time shots. Obviously, the one at the buzzer. Was it at the buzzer to send it to overtime?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Buzzer beater. So two buzzer beaters in a row from the Suns. And then, in overtime, that ridiculous shot fading away out of bounds, a nice little kiss off the top of the glass, and it somehow drops in for the and one.
Ugh. Just,
was that real?
That's
like
he's out I've there watched playing that highlight. Horse.
I've watched that highlight at least 20 times, and it almost doesn't feel real.
Shout out to EJ for trying to pretend like Booker did that on purpose, like bounce it off. I was listening to that. I was like, all right, EJ, like I love it, but come on, man.
Yeah, no.
Booker knows his angles.
I mean, he probably did take geometry pretty recently. He's only 20.
I was just gonna say that he's playing geometry while everyone else is playing pre-algebra.
Here's another bad nickname: the protractor.
The protractor.
Ooh. Oh,
that one's great. I love it.
Let's sweep that. We'll sweep that one off the side. That's no good. That's no good. But
go.
What was good is what I was going to say, but we ruined it. So just cut that out.
So what was good?
We got to talk about PJ Tucker's defense on Anthony Davis throughout the end stretch of that game. Davis could barely even catch the ball. So what did you guys think about PJ?
Yeah, I mean, last week we said how out of shape and not ready to play he looked, and 1 week later he just turns it around like nothing. So whatever you're doing, just keep doing it, PJ. You're fine. Anthony Davis had 22 points and 11 rebounds and 4 blocks. He was minus 6. That actually doesn't sound like too bad of a stat line, but when you take into account that Davis has been scoring 40 or 50 points each night, that's pretty darn good. And PJ did a great job shutting him down.
Can we talk about how we're saying that 22 and 11 with 4 blocks is like that's not that good of a game. How big of expectations does Anthony Davis have?
That just shows how good Anthony Davis is.
Like, that's a good game. Anthony Davis is great. But you were expecting more out of him than that, weren't you, heading into the game?
Not when Lance Stevenson won't pass him the ball.
Oh, dude. I think Alvin Gentry
needs to be fired.
Well,
I love
as long as he gets as long as he gets an open palmed slap right across the face of Lance Stevenson first. Man, he would be a tough guy to coach.
Dude, Anthony Davis needs to open slap Alvin Gentry first and tell him to just inbound me the ball and let me draw a foul. I mean,
yeah,
come on,
you know,
man.
Like watching Stevenson like get upset that he's getting pulled at the end of the game. Like, dude, this is not your team. This is Anthony Davis's team. Like, you don't matter that much. You're just a filler for the time being. Like, you're kind of a jokester.
I can't believe, first of all, Lance Stevenson had that BS shot that I thought was like, all right, this is how we lose. Oh. I guess Ty brought it down. Another one of those great ones. But, all right, so I kind of just want to talk about Anthony Davis after having to talk about Lance Stevenson. First of all, he looked bigger than Tyson Chandler, in my opinion. Just more muscular, bigger. Which means that he should just be playing center. I mean, even you can talk about how, like, he can play power forward, and he should play power forward, but just put him at center and let him run pick and roll with everyone, and that's just what it's going to do. And the fact that he didn't get any, like, touches, basically, in overtime, because Lance Stevenson was being Lance Stevenson is just ridiculous. And Alvin Gentry needs to do something about that.
I agree. And I think Alvin Gentry should really keep going with the lineup of Davis at center and Terrence Jones at power forward. Terrence Jones, I thought he was going to be too much for us to handle that game. He had a hot first quarter. I don't think he ended up with a ton, though.
He had 18 points, I think.
He had 19.
19. Yeah, so that's a solid game, but, and actually I commented to you guys, it seemed like he was just too much for Dudley to handle. I said, this is when we need to put Marquise Chris in, get some size out on a guy like that. But we didn't see that till a little later. Chris did get some solid minutes, but that was my thing. Terrence Jones made that pretty rough on us in the first quarter. Is that going to continue to happen if we're starting Dudley?
Yeah, I think so. When we get some of these guys that have some bigger lineups that they can throw out there, I mean, Terrence Jones really isn't their normal starting power forward, which I think he should. I know he has a lot of games where he's just, like, average, but he looked really good as just a guy that he can, that Anthony Davis can throw the ball out to and hit a jump shot. I think that Dudley will get abused by some of these bigger guys, and it's unfortunate. but it's just going to happen. He's kind of a tweener. He plays solid perimeter defense. It's his post defense that can get a little rough when he's playing against, like, Blake Griffin or LaMarcus Aldridge or any of those.
So let me parlay this into another question. Could we see P.J. Tucker possibly take the starting role from Jared Dudley soon this season? Or do you think it could happen at all?
If I'm being honest, I think that's what we have to do. I think what we need, if we bring Dudley off the bench, let him either sub in at small forward or power forward, whichever one we need, and start Warren and Tucker, I think we should probably try that. Tucker will give us more defense, but it also stops us from taking Warren out of the starting lineup. Dude's been playing so good and so consistent that I don't want him out of the starting lineup. Even if PJ Tucker is healthy, I do not want PJ starting at small forward.
No, TJ has to start, definitely. He has been playing way too well. And, you know, in this game against the Pelicans, he played more minutes than anyone else. He had 40 minutes. He had 18 points, 6 rebounds, and 4 steals. His efficiency wasn't as good as it has been. He was 4 for 17. But, I mean, I like that he had 4 steals. He turned it up on defense for sure.
You know what I really liked about PJ Tucker in this game? Just no regard for mankind. Has Anthony Davis on his shoulder, just throws up a baby hook right over him. Just right. Yep. And it's all net, too. Like, it just drops right through.
Yeah, that was crazy.
Why do I ever doubt you, PJ?
Between that and the offensive rebound a game that he ends up laying back in while he's, like, in the middle of the paint, like, that's when I remember how much I love PJ Tucker. And just talking about PJ Tucker, he did get the first minutes off the bench. At 6 minutes and 7 seconds left in the quarter, I believe it was, he gets subbed into the game, and he's the first one. Not Brandon Knight, not whatever. He's subbed in for Jared Dudley right away.
Not Big Sauce.
Not Tyler Ulis, not Barbosa, not anyone else on our bench. It's PJ. I think that says one thing, that he is really close to being 100%. And another thing, that when we had PJ and TJ out on the floor, we looked really good, in my opinion. And Dudley's a guy that you're not going to have to worry about really causing an issue because he's going to the bench. He is here for a veteran presence. I think we need to start PJ and TJ. And that little inbounds play at the end to get TJ the dunk that would win the game, basically, That was great, and those guys have some great communication between them.
That was definitely such a beautiful on the money pass. He didn't lob it in there. He put it on a line only where TJ could catch it. It was like a beautifully placed touchdown pass, and it ended with the game-winning two-handed slam from TJ. Just, man, it was so good. I feel so good. But hey, let's turn that feel good level down a little bit. Oh,
no.
Okay.
I do have to say one more feel good. I think we need to see that lineup more. With PJ Tucker at center, TJ Warren at power forward, and then Knight, Bledsoe, and Booker in the game all at the same time.
That was really fun.
I think we need to see that lineup a little bit more because of the fact that we can do it against, you know, when a team goes small, but also we can play really fast and still keep up a lot of defensive intensity. So I think we should try that out a little bit more. So now go ahead and bring our cool down.
I can bring the feel-good meter back down here. Okay, I hate to do it, but we're talking about PJ being the first man off the bench, and that replaces Knight as the technical sixth man of the team. And then we look at Brandon Knight's stats for this game, and again, we don't go off plus-minus exclusively for making our decisions on how well a guy played in a game, but Brandon Knight minus 25.
It's rough.
By far the worst on the roster. And I mean, and then if you look at his PER, 8.35, and that's third worst on the team behind PJ, who we have to give a pass because he's coming back hot, and then Big Sauce Allen Williams.
Yeah, but you also have to give a pass too.
Yes,
It's obviously he hasn't had enough time to properly distribute the sauce.
Yeah, and he will. But it's tough, you know, Brandon Knight, he's got some work to do.
And per Basketball Reference, his usage percentage is at like 25%. So according to Basketball Reference, you can kind of go off of that because he doesn't really assist anyways. That by just turnovers and like field goal attempts and makes, he is shouldering a ton of the load on offense. And when that happens, we're getting outscored a lot.
Right on. Well, can we turn the move on and turn the feel good meter back up?
Definitely.
Pump it up.
All right. Then it's time to talk about this emerging trio that we have here in Phoenix. Eric Bledsoe, Devin Booker, and TJ Warren have all had excellent starts to the season, and we're all hyped about it. And here at Sunny in Phoenix, we know it's early, but I think we're going to firmly establish ourselves as the conductors of the Bledsoe, Booker, Warren hype train. What do you guys
choo
think about that?
Yeah, all aboard.
That's right.
It's been great.
So the three have combined to average just under 60 points per game. And that kind of firepower coming out of the backcourt and small forward position, that's a lot for other teams to have to handle. That makes their starters have to play impeccable defense. So in order for the Suns to keep this up and maybe hopefully keep winning some games, is this sustainable? Could the trio keep scoring 60 per game throughout the entire season? Is it too early to say that? What do you guys think?
I think, if I remember correctly, I said that I thought Booker would average over 19. I think I said around 20. I think I said that Bledsoe would probably average around 17, maybe a little under. TJ Warren is where I really have no idea how much he can sustain. I think that Booker and Bledsoe are probably going to be able to sustain some of the play that they've been doing. My big question is if TJ, if he keeps his starting spot, if throughout the entire season he'll be able to keep up this kind of production.
Yeah, I mean, I would love to say that they can keep averaging 60 points, but that's a lofty goal. I just think whatever they do, I'm fine with. They are just playing so well. If it's 60, great. If it's 70, even better. If it's 40, that's fine too. You know, their all around games are so good. And if someone else needs to get hot aside from one of those three, we have people who can do that. Marquise Chris has yet to have a huge game. He's due for one. Bender hasn't had a whole lot of playing time. He's due to have a big game eventually. Brandon Knight has big games here and there. We know that. I just think just keep doing what you're doing and don't worry too much about the point totals.
I think I just want to stress just continued consistency, which I think kind of goes in hand. I'm going to be okay if TJ averages like 15 points. I'm not going to be against that. But my big thing is I want to see him play an entire season. We still have to remember yes. that he's played, what, I think a combined 86 games his first two seasons. I want to say, I think that's right. I'm going to go with that. But I want to see him play an entire season. And if that's averaging 22 points, awesome. If that's averaging 15 points, still awesome. If that's averaging 11 points, I mean, that's technically around his career average, but he's better than that.
Right. I think I pegged TJ, excuse me, for a 15-point-per-game scorer this year. That's what I was being hopeful for. But you made a good note about keeping these guys healthy, and one of the notes I had written down here is I didn't even think this was going to be a thing this year. I didn't think Bledsoe and Warren would be 100% right away to start the year. I was expecting a slow start from those guys especially, but I'll admit it, I couldn't have been more wrong, and that's fantastic for this case. So, yeah. I mean, just those guys being healthy, that's big time, and I'm glad that they're able to do it from the start of the season here.
Yeah, I definitely thought we were going to be talking about Killer Bees and not BBW.
I mean, yeah, I'm pleasantly surprised too, and they're building some really great chemistry out there too, which is a big part of it. And you know, you can see post-game interviews and stuff, if you ever watch those, you know, these guys are so happy for each other when they have big games. There's no one saying, "I wish that was me," or anything like that. They're just applauding their teammates, and it's awesome.
Absolutely. And one other point that I want to talk about with these three being a sustainable trio and a trio that can stay out there and get minutes and compete with any lineup they see, these guys are playing defense. TJ Warren, much improved on the defensive end. You can tell he's staying in front of guys. He has those quick hands. He gets steals. He can start the fast break like that. That's been great to see this year. And even Booker. Booker's defense has stepped up. You can tell, if you look at Booker, I just happened to watch his first basket in the NBA on a YouTube video the other day, and he looked like a string bean. Now if you look at Booker, his chest definitely has some more muscle on it, and his shoulders and arms too. There's a noticeable change. So Booker knows that he's got to put up with some big boys, the Joe Johnsons, like those type guys. He's got to guard them, so I think he did the right thing. And obviously Bledsoe, he can play D, he can shut guys down, and I think that's kind of the underrated thing when we see them scoring all these points. They're playing pretty decent defense too.
Yeah, and let's not talk about, I mean, of course, Booker is still getting scored on, but if you look at just his positioning and stuff, he's getting there. So I think you have to applaud him for that. And, I mean, we're not going to question, really, Bledsoe's two-way potential. He's there.
All right, so anything more about the trio that we should discuss here?
Probably not. We talked a lot.
Probably need to keep watching them.
Probably not. Let's just, I'm getting hyped to watch this game. It starts in an hour, so. Anyways, let's move on to the game previews. Yeah, we're running long. We'll keep these quick again. And this is probably a good week to keep them quick. The Suns head to Portland Tuesday night to play the Blazers again already in this early season. After that, we head back home to play the Pistons the next night. Then we get a couple days off before another home game, this one against the Brooklyn Nets. But we'll quickly talk about the Blazers game. Do we have it in us to steal another one away from them? Can we beat them again?
You know, is it strange that I swear, like, the last, like, three seasons, we've been paired up against Portland twice in, like, the first opening month?
Was last year Portland back-to-back
home and away? Yeah, last year we had Portland back-to-back home and away. It was ridiculous.
Right. I got to see the first game of the season at home, the Nash induction, and then they headed right back to Portland after that. That's weird.
Yeah. It was nuts. And we actually won the series last year with Portland with an inferior team. And I think that since Portland is still struggling with some chemistry issues right now, they're still trying to figure out what to do with Evan Turner, I think, and Festus Ezeli's still been out, I think. I'm going to roll with that. I think that getting them early in the season is a good thing because they're still figuring things out, kind of similar to how they were last season when they lost LMA, they lost Robin Lopez and stuff. I think that will be a good thing to do as a possibility of being able to win this game.
Yeah. Can we beat them? Yes.
I could definitely see us stealing another one away from the Blazers. It'll be a little tougher at their house, I assume. But if we keep Dame and McCollum under locks, there's no reason why we can't win this game.
I'm just terrified of Dame time.
Oh, yeah.
I don't want him dropping 45 on us.
Yeah. Bledsoe knows what he has coming for him, though, so let's hope he's prepared again. And then after this one, Pistons game, we got a Morris brother coming back to Phoenix. We're all happy about that. Love seeing the Morris brothers bless Talking Stick Resort Arena with their presence. We just love it. So... And, man, I know I don't have much to say about this game or the Nets game, So whatever you guys want to throw out, just go with it. It's all you.
Yeah, all I have about either of them is that the game against the Pistons could be rough since it's the second game of a back-to-back and we'll be traveling right before. So that could be tough. The Pistons are a decent team. And Marcus Morris, we don't need to say anything. And then the game against the Nets, I'm a lot more hopeful for. You know, they're one of the lower end teams, and we have some time in between Wednesday and Saturday, so that'll be really nice.
Man, I didn't know we were going back to back with what we were saying with the East. Jeez, Mitch. I'm just kidding. what I want to say about the Pistons real quick is, one, the league is better when the Pistons are, you're able to hate them.
Bad boys.
So, like, you have the bad boys, you have the no superstar team that won the championship. I think the Pistons are just a more fun team to watch when you can hate them, which I definitely do with a Morris brother on there. And the Pistons are going to play small. They're going to have Tobias Harris and Marcus Morris starting, I'm pretty sure. They're not going to lose anything when it comes to rebounding, because Andre Drummond has already had two 20-20 games. Dude is a monster, and I think this year or next is really where he needs to try and make it more known that he's probably one of the best centers in the game right now, and I think people forget about him.
Yep, I can agree with that. But anyways...
It's true, I just did forget about him, so...
Great already?
That was fast.
Well, you said Andre Drummond, and I was like, oh, right, he's on the Pistons now.
All right, there we go. I think it's definitely to the point of the show where it's time for our non-sports plugs. It's time for David's Comic Book Corner, Mitch's Face Melting Minute, and then I have a couple crispy random treats for you. So, ooh. David, go ahead. And I don't mean that seriously at all, so...
Are we sure that those aren't crispy... crunchy treats. I almost said tweets. Oh my god. This week for my comic book corner, of course, want to shout out, because Doctor Strange came out on Friday, November 4th. I went and saw it. I really can't wait to go see it again. It's just a solid movie, I think. I'm not sure if it does anything new, but just visually, it's a really good movie. And acting, it's got great acting in it. So I'm going to go with that. And then I'm also going to shout out a Doctor Strange book that I just finished, which is Doctor Strange, Don't Pay the Ferryman. Which is, it's kind of titled after that old saying of don't pay the ferryman until he takes you to where you want to go. Starts off written by Roger Stern and then goes in by Peter Gillis, I believe is his name, with art by Buscema and Warner. It's just a solid story. It's good. It has a clear line, and if you really want to know Doctor Strange, that's good to read. If you really, really want to know about Doctor Strange, I would recommend The Oath by Brian K. Vaughan and Doctor Strange Season 1 by Greg Pak. Those are both just solid ways to get into the character of Doctor Strange. If you want to know more after watching the movie, that's what I would recommend.
Okay, I bet a lot of you assume that we're recording this podcast here in some big fancy studio with top of the line equipment, but sometimes, that's not true. We don't have nice internet connections. We're on Google Hangouts. We're just throwing this stuff together. But I will say, when David's connection goes out, the best time for it to go out and become choppy is when he's talking about comic books, like he just was. I didn't pick up like half of that, but we can just roll with it. It's perfect.
Yeah, you guys just zone out anyways. It's not that big of a deal.
So, and I didn't hear what you said anyway, so it's perfect.
So like I'd normally say, cool, good stuff, David. And then I'll move into mine. So here we go. I stumbled across what I consider to be the best vocal cover artist on the internet on YouTube. This guy's name is John Sudano. That's his YouTube page. Check that out. And he exclusively sings the song All Star by everybody's favorite band, Smash Mouth, to the tune of different songs. And this guy just embodies the internet. Like, if you picture a guy perusing message boards at 1 a.m. Like, this is the guy. And he's just bringing it hard with Smash Mouth covers. Every week one comes out, and it's so good. But I got one more for you guys, because I just saw this right before we started. Okay. I'm here to tell you that there is, in fact, a television show called Martha and Snoop's Potluck Dinner Party on VH1. And, yeah, we're talking about Martha Stewart. That's the truth here. But two things. First, this sounds fascinating, and I have to catch an episode. Second, good to know VH1 is still a channel. That's all. Mitch, you're up.
Oh, well, that sounds great. Yeah, the John Sudano stuff is really funny. I had no idea what he was, and saw it on Facebook that he's like, here's my cover of Creep by Radiohead. I check it out, and, you know, Creep starts like it does, and all of a sudden, somebody once told me that. Oh, so funny. So funny. Just definitely check that out. Great plug. My plug is a little different this week. I'm going to plug a YouTube channel. I have been watching a lot of different guitar players on YouTube for a while, but one of my favorites is Sarah Longfield. You can check out her YouTube channel and her website, sarahshreds.bandcamp.com. And she is the female Tosin Abasi in my mind. For anyone who follows prog metal, that's the Animals as Leaders guitar player, who was just amazing as well. But Sarah Longfield has a lot of great covers, original stuff. She's really good at tapping. She also has an abnormally short pinky. And so when she's playing, she puts her pinky out like she's really fancy and then plays with three fingers most of the time and is still a much better guitar player than a lot of people I've seen. So definitely check her out. Really, really good stuff.
All right. That's beautiful. That's a good way to end the show. And that's going to do it. Be sure to check us out on social media. Follow us on Twitter under the handle @SunnyandPHXPod. Find us on Facebook under the name Phoenix Suns Multiple Sources. Hit us up through email with questions or suggestions at sunnyandphxpod@gmail.com. Head over to the website at sunnyandphx.com and the entire Multiple Sources blog and podcast network. Thanks for tuning in, Go Suns.
Go!